Where you go? Assalamualaikum Prof. Surati.
Waalaikumsalam. Pak Dekan sudah masuk ya?
Waalaikumsalam Prof. Tim. Ya, saya cuba nak dapatkan superior saya. Okay. So we'll wait for. Can you give me a minute?
Afternoon, Prof.
Ya.
Yeah. Okay. Adi Negara. Selamat siang.
Ya. Yeah. Ya,
Assalamualaikum.
Selamat siang, ya. Bagaimana di sana kabarnya?
Jelas.
Jelas, ya. Ya, bagus. Alhamdulillah. Ya.
Assalamualaikum, Prof. Adi Negara.
Ya, waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Ya, waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ya.
Ya, assalamualaikum. Jadi kami sudah bersedia.
Baik.
Bersama saya dah ada chief executive with us, chief executive Prof. Jasper and my team.
Okay. Okay. Bisa, ya, bisa kita mulai? Bisa. Ya.
Yes, bisa.
Ya, okay, baik. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala asrofil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala alihi washabbihi ajmain amma ba'du. Segala puji kita panjatkan kepada Allah Subhanahu wa taala yang telah memberikan nikmat kesehatan bagi kita semua. Salawat serta salam kita curahkan selalu kepada Nabi besar sallallahu alaihi wasallam beserta keluarga dan sahabat-sahabatnya. Good afternoon everyone. I am delighted to welcome you today at collaborative webinar held by Faculty Medicine of UMS and Malacca Manipal Medical College. Before I go further, I would like to thank our distinguished guests, all speakers from Indonesia. Our first speaker, Professor Suradi from 11 Maret University, here also as a counselor at our Medical Faculty of UMS. Our second speaker from Indonesia is Professor A.M. Sutrisna. He is our Dean of Faculty of Medicine UMS. Professor A.M., please raise your hand.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam. That is our Dean. And I would like to also greet speaker from Malaysia, Professor Dr. Yasodhara from Yay. Hello, Professor.
Yeah.
Our second speaker, Professor Dr. M. Nachiappan.
Hello.
Yay, Professor Nachiappan. Thank you very much for joining with us. And then I would like also to greet Professor Dr. Jaspal Singh. He is a Chief Executive Malacca Manipal Medical College, a prominent speaker and guest lecturer on ENT in Malaysia and overseas. Professor Jaspal Singh?
Yeah, he's with us. Yeah, he is.
Okay, and the last one that I would like to greet is Professor Adi Negara as the Dean of Malacca Medical College. With all of your college, Waalaikumsalam, with all of your college, student, and lecturer from Malaysia, welcome and thank you for training with us today. Before starting this event, first we listen to a speech from our dean, Medical Faculty AFUAMES. Kepada Profesor E.M. Sutrisna, saya silakan.
Thank you very much. Sorry. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin, wa bihi nasta'inu 'ala umuri dunyawatin. Wassalatu wassalamu 'ala asyrofil anbiya'i wal mursalin, syahadu an la ilaha illallah wa syahadu asyhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu kana bi akbar. Yang kami hormati Honorable Profesor Adi Negara bin Lutfi Abbas, as Dean of College Medicine, Malacca Manipal Medical School. Malaysia. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Profesor Dr. Sval Singh, as Chief Executive of MMG, Malaysia. Profesor Dr. Suradi, Pulmonologist, Director of UMS and UNS, Muhammadiyah, Surakarta, Fakultas Medicine. Profesor Dr. Yasodhara PM, as Speaker from Malaysia. Profesor Dr. M. Nachiappan, as Speaker from Malaysia. Let's pray to Allah SWT, because blessing, we can end this meeting. Webinar collaboration between Fakultas Medicine UMS University Muhammadiyah Surakarta with Malacca Manipal Medical College Malaysia. Salam salam, wa Prophet Muhammad Rasulullah. Ladies and gentlemen, Bapak Ibu, this event is collaboration between Fakultas Medicine UMS with MMC, and it is the first implementation of the MOU between Faculty of Medicine of UMS with Malacca Medical School of College, which was signed a few months ago. This webinar is held as form our concern and contribution to COVID-19 pandemic. Hopefully, that from this webinar, we can give contribution for handling this pandemic as one of our responsibility in place of member of medical society. Deep concern of the COVID-19 outbreak, some of themes that will be present. Dr. Suradi, as a learn from Malaysia, COVID-19 management, first line treatment, candidate to treating COVID-19, and the role of universal precaution during COVID-19 pandemic. Ladies and gentlemen, Bapak Ibu, I hope the collaboration between Faculty of Medicine, UMS with MMC, will continue for further in the future, next time. Maybe form of webinar series, student exchange maybe, pasca COVID, staff exchange, pasca COVID, and research exchange and research collaboration, and others. Thanks very much to all participants, and special thanks to Dean, Professor Dr. Abdul Gara, and all speaker. Insyaallah, Allah endorse this webinar. Thank you very much. Terima kasih. Syukran.
Terima kasih atas sambutannya, Bapak Dekan FKUMS. The second speech will be delivered by Dean of Malacca Medical College kepada Profesor Adi Negara. Saya persilakan.
Terima kasih, Dr. I. Novita. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam sejahtera saya hulurkan pada semua-semua guest-guest daripada Indonesia dan juga daripada Malaysia. So very good afternoon to all of you. It gives me great pleasure to be here. I would like to introduce the team from Malacca Manipal Medical College. We have our Respected Chief Executive Professor Dr. Jaspal Singh Sahota. We have also Professor Dr. M. Nachiakan, who is the Director of Clinical Studies and Student Affairs. We have Prof. Yashodhara, who is the physician from the Faculty of Medicine and also the chairperson of numerous committees in Melaka Manipal Medical College. Our warmest greetings to Professor Dr. M. Sutrisna, the Dean of the Faculty of Medicine of Universitas Muhammadiyah Surakarta. Assalamualaikum, Professor Dr. M. Sutrisna.
Waalaikumsalam, Professor.
Waalaikumsalam. Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Dr. M. Sutrisna, together with Dr. Indovita. Thank you so much for having this collaboration, this memorandum of agreement, to something fruitful for us, because we will definitely be, making use of these collaborative activities together with you, with all of you. This would be our first foray together as part and parcel of this collaborative team. We thank you so much because you all have, come and reach out to us, and we really, really thank you for this. And we also like to greet the other speakers from your side. Prof. Suradi, who is a pulmonologist. Prof. Suradi, are you there? Yeah. Okay. So anyway, we are in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic, and this pandemic has lots of unique items attached to it. First discovered in perhaps in 17 November, the first index case was in China. 17 November 1999, that's why you have this COVID-19 rather than COVID-20, even though most of the fatalities are in 2020. But then from 17 November 2019 has spread throughout the globe. At this point in time, we see 188 countries. I think the entire nation of the world are afflicted with this COVID-19. The only nations or geographical regions that are not affected would be, I suppose, Antarctica and Arctic. Yeah. And the rest of the world, the rest of the globe is immersed with this pandemic that has caused lots of fatalities. I gather that as of today, 315,000 deaths have been recorded. So out of 4.71 million cases throughout the world, so this with great importance that we have this COVID-19 webinar. So thank you so much to hear of the development that is being conducted, or the things that you are doing over in Indonesia, and we'd like to share also what we are doing in Malaysia, so that this would be for the betterment of life. With perhaps we can share this with our colleagues later on, so that we can have better quality of life, better preventive measures, by going through this webinar. So with that, I thank all of you. All right, thank you so much. Over to you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Adinegara, untuk sambutannya. Okay, let's start our first sessions. Our first sessions, our speaker will be Professor Dr. Suradi, spesialis paru konsultan, seorang pulmonologist, guru besar, senior lecturer di Faculty of Medicine Universitas 11 Maret, Surakarta, and also a counselor of pulmonologists in Faculty of Medicine UMS. Judul yang akan beliau sampaikan adalah Lesson from Indonesia COVID-19 Management, Latest Number of Cases and Therapy Applied in Our Country. Kepada Profesor Suradi, waktu dan tempat saya persilahkan, waktunya 15 menit.
Oh ya, terima kasih. Terima kasih. Thank you for datarin. Baik, untuk mempercepat waktu, mempersingkat waktu, saya mulai. Saya kira opini ini sudah sering kita temukan bahwa opini mengenai masalah penularan virus corona itu, apakah dari manusia ke binatang atau kemudian manusia ke manusia, tapi bagaimanapun opini ini sudah kita ketahui bahwa coronavirus penularannya adalah dari manusia ke manusia sampai saat ini. Sebaran COVID-19 khususnya apa yang terjadi pada saat ini adalah yang dapat kita ketahui adalah Indonesia 0,37% dari kasus global. Kemudian confirm 4 juta total 4.716.513. Kemudian total ada 315.225. Nah, jumlah terbanyak di dunia saat ini, nomor pertama adalah Yusha 1.486.757. Kemudian Rusia 281.752. United Kingdom Inggris 244.995. Dan kita di Indonesia itu nomor 33. Nah, bagaimana update dari COVID-19 di Indonesia? Angka seperti kita lihat di sini bahwa angka kematian angka kematian per tanggal 10 Mei itu sebesar 1.148. Kemudian angka kasus aktif sebanyak 13.000. Kemudian angka total kasus 17.514. Total kasus recovery itu 4.129. Inilah update COVID-19 per 10 Mei 2020. Ini kita lihat bahwa total kasus yang berwarna kuning itu sebesar 17.514. Adapun yang aktif 13.000. Sedangkan recovery 4.129 dan hitam angka kematian 1.148. Nah, kalau kita membaca jurnal yang dirilis oleh Cina, ya, dengan systematic review and meta analysis, maka clinical symptom yang banyak adalah fever, demam, batuk dan nyeri tenggorokan. Khususnya adalah gejala-gejala pada sistem saluran pernapasan dari atas. Lainnya bervariasi antara sistem saluran pencernaan dan mialgia, atrial mialgia. Temuan yang menonjol di sini adalah leukositosis, kemudian limfosit cenderung terdepresi, dan penurunan angka platelet. Penemuan pada radiologi, chest CT finding, maka pneumonia menunjukkan tanda-tanda yang menyolok. Nah, komplikasi yang sering ditemukan adalah adult respiratory distress, cardiac failure, shock, dan renal insufficient. Nah, di sini di Indonesia khususnya kita apa yang kita lakukan untuk deteksi dini pasien dalam pengawasan pemantauan probable atau confirm COVID-19 kita sebutkan sebagai pasien pada pengawasan bila mengalami demam lebih dari 38 derajat Celsius dengan diikuti batuk pilek dengan respiratory upper respiratory symptom. Juga ditemukan adanya pneumonia ringan hingga berat berdasar gejala klinik dan atau radiologis. Dengan demikian perlu waspada pada pasien dengan gangguan sistem kekebalan tubuh immunocompromised. Karena gejala dan tanda menjadi tidak jelas, ini yang menjadikan kita mesti waspada. Misalnya pada umur lanjut atau penderita-penderita dengan diabetes. Dan disertai minimal satu kondisi berikut. Riwayat perjalanan ke China atau wilayah negara yang terjangkit sesuai di perkembangan penyakit. Seorang petugas kesehatan yang sakit dengan gejala yang sama setelah merawat pasien. Seorang dengan respiratory infection ringan sampai berat dalam waktu 14 hari sebelum sakit, maka juga perlu mendapatkan perhatian. Apalagi bila mana yang bersangkutan ada riwayat perjalanan ke Wuhan atau kontak dengan orang yang memiliki riwayat perjalanan ke Wuhan. Dalam hal ini adalah kaitannya dengan hubungan epidemiologis dan memiliki demam lebih dari 38 derajat Celsius. Terus bagaimana dengan orang dalam pemantauan? Seorang yang mengalami gejala demam, ya, respiratory infection, riwayat berjalan ke Cina atau wilayah negara yang terjangkit dalam waktu 14 hari dan tidak memiliki satu atau lebih riwayat paparan atau kontak. Nah, termasuk kontak erat yang bagaimana? Termasuk kontak erat adalah petugas kesehatan, orang yang merawat atau menunggu pasien, orang yang tinggal serumah dengan pasien, atau tamu yang berada dalam satu ruangan dengan pasien. Disebut kasus probable bila mana pasien dalam pengawasan yang diperiksa untuk COVID-19 tetapi inkonklusif, tidak dapat disimpulkan, atau seseorang dengan hasil konfirmasi positif dan pan coronavirus atau beta coronavirus. Adapun kasus konfirmasi atau PDP, kita nyatakan demikian bila mana yang terinfeksi COVID-19 dengan hasil pemeriksaan laboratorium positif. Orang tanpa gejala kita masukkan dalam kelompok ini bila mana seseorang yang tidak bergejala dan memiliki risiko tertular dari orang confirm COVID-19. Orang tanpa gejala ini merupakan kontak erat dengan kasus konfirmasi COVID-19. Nah, oleh karena itu, maka kita akan mendapatkan satu kondisi manifestasi klinik yang berhubungan dengan infeksi COVID-19. Yang pertama adalah kelompok incomplete illness, gejala tidak spesifik. Kemudian pneumonia ringan, pasien dengan pneumonia tidak ada tanda-tanda pneumonia yang berat. Misalnya anak dengan pneumonia ringan, mengalami batuk atau kesulitan bernafas. Kemudian ada pneumonia berat, bila pasien remaja atau dewasa dengan demam atau dalam pengawasan infeksi saluran napas, respiratory tract infection, ditambah satu dari frekuensi napas lebih dari 30 kali per menit, ada distress pernapasan yang berat, atau saturasi oksigen SpO2 kurang dari 90% pada udara kamar. Sampai pada kondisi di mana berat, yaitu acute respiratory distress syndrome. Onset baru terjadi atau perburukan dalam waktu 1 minggu. Penyebabnya tidak ada lain, yang sering kita temukan adalah edema paru. Gagal napas yang bukan akibat gagal jantung atau kelebihan cairan, bukan karena kelebihan cairan atau overloading cairan. Perlu dalam hal ini pemeriksaan yang objektif dengan ekokardiografi untuk menyingkirkan bahwa penyebab edema bukan akibat hidrostatika jika tidak ditemukan faktor risiko. Kemudian kelompok sepsis, yaitu pasien dewasa di mana terjadi disfungsi organ yang mengancam nyawa disebabkan oleh disregulasi respon tubuh terhadap dugaan atau terbukti infeksi. Dan yang terakhir adalah shock septic, di mana seorang pasien dewasa mengalami hipotensi yang menetap meskipun sudah dilakukan resusitasi cairan dan membutuhkan vasopressor untuk mempertahankan main arterial pressure lebih dari 65 mm Hg dan kadar laktat serum lebih dari 2 mm mol. Nah, sehingga kita berpanduan pada praktek klinik untuk penanganan pneumonia COVID-19. Berat dengan komplikasi bila mulai pneumonia COVID-19 ringan, berat, sangat berat. Kriteria diagnostik seorang dengan demam atau demam pada respiratory dan tidak ada penyebab lain berdasarkan gambaran klinik yang meyakinkan, disertai dengan perjalanan dari wilayah terjangkit, riwayat kontak. Itulah patokan-patokan atau panduan-panduan kita di dalam upaya untuk menangani penderita dengan COVID-19. Bila mana ringan, pneumonia ringan, gejala tidak spesifik, biasanya ini kita temukan demikian. Pasien dengan pneumonia dengan tidak ada tanda-tanda pneumonia berat. Berat bila mana seorang penderita dengan demam atau dijugai infeksi saluran napas ditambah dengan frekuensi dengan respirasi lebih dari 30 kali per menit dan distres napas berat dengan SpO2 kurang dari 90% udara ruangan. Berat dengan komplikasi bila ditemukan adalah respiratory distress, sepsis, bahkan sampai terjadi subsepsis. Tata laksana pneumonia yang diitarkan adalah melakukan isolasi diri atau self-isolation. Bila tidak ada rumah atau untuk isolasi diri, dapat dirawat inapkan di rumah sakit. Medikamentosa yang sering kita gunakan adalah paracetamol, oseltamivir, vitamin C oral. Kemudian untuk pneumonia yang berat, kita isolasi pada semua kasus, kemudian implementasi pencegahan dan pengendalian infeksi, kemudian dilakukan serial fototoraks, terapi oksigen nasal kanul, terapi cairan ketat, terapi sintomatik anti demam dengan paracetamol. Selain itu juga diberikan antibiotika empirik berdasarkan epidemiologi dan pola kuman setempat secepat mungkin sampai diagnosis ditegakkan, yaitu kita menggunakan levofloxacin intravena 790 mg per 24 jam. Jika terdapat gangguan fungsi hati, ya, diganti dengan macrolide 4, contohnya azitromisin 1 kali 500 ml. Kemudian tetap dengan oseltamivir 2 kali 7 ml per oral, hepatoprotektor, vitamin C IV, kloroquin fosfat 2 kali 500 mg, obat-obat lain sesuai komorbid, dan yang utama pula adalah mencegah komplikasi selama perawatan. Bila mana terjadi komplikasi, maka perlu kita lakukan hal-hal untuk mencegah lebih lanjut. Implementasi pencegahan dan pengendalian infeksi sangat utama. Serial fototoraks, terapi oksigen, antibiotika kombinasi quinolone, yaitu levofloxacin 750 mg per 24 jam ditambah dengan meropenem 3 kali 1000 mg intravena. Tetap diberikan oseltamivir 2 kali 75 mg per oral dan melalui NGT. Begitu juga kita tambahkan kloroquin fosfat, steroid tidak dianjurkan. Paracetamol 3 kali 500 mg. Vitamin C 1 kali 400 mg. Obat lain sesuai dengan komorbid kalau ada, cairan terapi cairan itu perlu efektif, tahan shock sesuai alur, cegah komplikasi selama perawatan, bahwa sampai saat ini kita belum menemukan anti COVID-19. Bila mana terjadi komplikasi, terjadi munculnya ARDS, maka kita perlu kedepankan atau perlu kita lakukan ventilasi mekanik dengan volume tidak yang rendah. Pada dewasa dengan ARDS berat direkomendasikan untuk prone ventilation selama 12-16 jam per hari. Pada ARDS yang sedang berat, gunakan PEEP yang tinggi dengan target saturasi di atas 88-92%. Gunakan strategi terapi cairan konservatif pada pasien ARDS tanpa hipoperfusi jaringan. Juga diberikan high flow nasal oksigen dan non-invasif ventilation hanya digunakan pada gagal nafas hipoksemik dan harus dimonitor secara ketat. Nah, akan kita sampaikan beberapa contoh kasus. Kita memiliki kasus seorang wanita umur 52 tahun, kita diagnosis sebagai PDV COVID-19 dengan keluhan respiratory, sesek, demam, dan seterusnya dari tenggorok. Kemudian tidak ada riwayat kontak berpergian ke daerah yang terjangkit, tidak memiliki komorbid. Seorang petani. Ya. Dia dirawat di rumah sakit di luar rumah sakit kita dengan pneumonia. Kemudian dirujuk ke rumah sakit kita. Pada saat masuk di rumah sakit kita, KU sedang, komposmentis, dan SpO2 99% oksigen dengan 8 liter per menit NRM. Ditemukan ronki di kedua belah lapangan paru. Ini ilustrasi gambar radiologi, kita temukan persublongan di hemitoraks kanan. Hasil laboratorium darah menunjukkan kenaikan leukosit 15,6 antaleukosit, kemudian neutrofil itu menunjukkan tanda-tanda 96,4% meningkat, limfositnya terdepres 1,7%, kemudian SKUT 100, dan kalau kita periksa NLR-nya, angkanya menunjukkan 5,53. Nah, sehingga kita assessment sebagai COVID-19. Pneumonia kumdas PSI 56. Nah, kita terapi dengan oksigen, diet TKTP, tinggi kalori tinggi protein, infusion, kemudian injeksi azitromisin 5 ml per 24 jam, vitamin C, hydronac 6 cc dalam NaCl 0,9%, 200 cc per 24 jam, hidrokloroquine 1 x 400 mg, Tamiflu Acephalavir 2 x 75 mg. Nah, belum kita dapatkan hasil definitif adanya coronavirus. Yaitu masih kita rencanakan untuk swab oropharynx dan nasofaring pada tanggal 14 April. Nah, sampai itu dengan pemeriksaan-pemeriksaan yang lain. Hasilnya kita pada follow up satu hari kemudian leukosit masih tinggi, neutrofil masih tinggi, limfosit masih terdepres. Kemudian hasil radiologi pada tangan hari ke berikutnya ya, masih menunjukkan tanda-tanda hemitoraks kanan yang demikian masif. Angka gas darah analisis itu menunjukkan tanda-tanda hipoksi. Kemudian kita assessment sebagai PDP COVID-19 dengan adult respiratory distress, pneumonia, disertai sepsis dan gagal napas hipoksemia. Seterusnya obat kita teruskan apa yang sudah kita berikan. Utamanya adalah azitromisin, oseltamivir, hidrokloroquine, dan terapi cairan ditambah dengan vitamin C. Kemudian evaluasi radiologi hari ke 3 ya, gambarannya tetap menunjukkan perselubungan pada hemitoraks kanan. Kemudian pada hari ke-4 sudah menunjukkan tanda-tanda perselubungan atau infiltrasi menjadi lebih berkurang atau membaik dengan SpO2 93% menggunakan CPAP 4-5 liter per menit. Kemudian pada hari ke 7 ya, hari ke 9 tanggal 19 April 20 kondisi klinik membaik, SpO2 98%, kemudian hipoksemi skornya 233, dan seterusnya pada tanggal 21 April hari ke-8 pengobatan kita baru mendapatkan hasil terkonfirmasi COVID-19 positif. Di sini pada hari ke-8 klinis sudah menjadi lebih baik dan gambaran radiologi infiltrat hemitoraks kanan sudah banyak berkurang. Terapi yang kita lakukan adalah meneruskan terapi yang sebelumnya, yaitu antibiotika dengan azitromisin, kemudian ditambah dengan hidrokloroquin dan oseltamivir tetap 2x75 mg, ditambah dengan vitamin C, terapi cairan, diet tinggi kalori, tinggi protein. Terkonfirmasi maka pada tanggal hari ke 24 hari ke 9 ya, hari ke 10 maka kondisi penderita menjadi lebih baik. Hemitoraks kanan gambaran infiltratnya sudah banyak berkurang. Pada hari ke-10 kondisi lebih baik. Kemudian terapi tetap kita lanjutkan dengan pemberian azitromisin, vitamin C, Tamiflu, hidrokloroquin. Ya, itu yang utama di samping terapi cairan. Defcon per 3 hari kita lakukan dan swab evaluasi pada ke 1, 2, 3 masih tunggu hasil, dan hari ke 14 hari ke 14 setelah terkonfirmasi positif tanggal 17 hari ke 14 hasil swab negatif 29 April dan pada 1 Mei ulangan swab itu negatif, kemudian dengan 2x negatif swab berturut-turut maka perbaikan klinis menunjukkan tanda-tanda yang positif, penderita kemudian kita eksekusi sebagai penderita COVID-19 dan dinyatakan sembuh dengan terapi rawat jalan. Dirawat jalan kan dengan terapi rawat jalan menggunakan azitromisin 1x500 mg dan vitamin C 2x1. Kasus pertama. Kasus kedua, umur 21 tahun. Ya. Gejala-gejala respiratory, kemudian gejala dan riwayat kontak, riwayat perawatan yang diperoleh dari rumah sakit daerah di Gemolong, Sragen, daerah kabupaten, daerah rural. Pasien dirujuk ke rumah sakit hari kedua setelah dari mondok di sana. Kemudian keadaan umum pada saat masuk rumah sakit kita adalah sedang tak sadar, komos mentis, kemudian tidak ada tanda-tanda shock. Kemudian kita lakukan gambar fototoraks ada sedikit invertat di hemitoraks kanan bawah. Hasil laboratorium antalekosit masih menunjukkan tanda-tanda 4,3, ya agak turun sedikit. Trombosit itu turun hebat. Neutrofil itu meningkat. Limfositnya itu terdepresi sehingga kita dapatkan nilai NLR 13,09. Kemudian pada hari kedua di rumah sakit kita, maka tanda-tandanya ada defisit oksigen, terjadi hipoksia. Kita eksekusi sebagai diagnostik penderita dengan PDV COVID-19. Kita diagnosis banding dengan DHF dengan permasalahan gagal nafas, hipoksemi, hiponatremi, hipokalemi, dan hipoalbuminemia. Hari ke berikutnya, hari keempat. Kemudian kita lakukan pengobatan, apa yang kita lakukan? Kita berikan terapi cairan, tetap dengan azitromisin dan vitamin C, hidrokloroquine, oseltamivir, Tamiflu 2 kali 70 mg, ditambah dengan paracetamol tablet 3 kali 500 mg, ditambah dengan kalium 15 mg dan plasbumin 25%. Kemudian kita programkan untuk ronsen torak follow up, di samping itu juga untuk swab jalan napas. Pada hari ke tanggal 23 April, hari ke 1 itu kita temukan tadi sudah leukosit 4,7, trombosit 3,6. Hari ke berapa? Ya, terapi ya tetap azitromisin ya. Kemudian hari kedua evaluasinya, tampilan darahnya itu tetap menunjukkan belum ada perubahan yang berarti. Neutrofil tetap meningkat, persentase limfosit tetap terdepresi. Hari ketiga tanda-tanda leukosit masih belum menunjukkan tanda perbaikan, neutrofil masih meningkat, limfosit masih terdepresi. Hasil rapid test IgG tinju positif, IgM tinju positif. Adapun anti HIV non reaktif. Albumin menunjukkan penurunan. Albumin menunjukkan penurunan. Tanggal evaluasi tanggal 27 April hari kelima, hemitoraks kanan kiri tanda-tanda perselubungan, gambaran sebagaimana sesuai edema paru. Kemudian hari ketujuh evaluasi, maka penunjukan tanda-tanda SpO2-nya itu 98% pada 6 liter per lapangan pandang, dan infiltrat di kedua lapangan paru sudah menurun, sudah menunjukkan tanda-tanda perbaikan. Hasil pada tanggal 23 April, hasil swab negatif ternyata. Pada tanggal 24 April, hasil swab negatif. Jadi artinya bahwa pasien tersebut bukan termasuk sebagai penderita COVID-19. Sehingga pasien dipindah rawatkan, tidak diisolasi lagi karena bukan termasuk penderita COVID-19. 19. Kasus ketiga, seorang penderita dengan umur lanjut 62 tahun dengan tanda-tanda respiratory infection, pekerjaan seorang penjual buah, ada gejala dan ada riwayat kontak. Penderita dirawat mula-mula di Rumah Sakit Umum Daerah Sragen tanggal 6 sampai 16, jadi 10 hari di rumah sakit daerah dengan rapid test negatif, swab dilakukan tanggal 6 April dan 8 April. Kemudian masuk ke rumah sakit kita tanggal 16 April. Berarti hari yang ke-10 dimasuk rumah sakit kita. Keadaan penderita sakit sedang, tetap kompos medis. Vital sign dalam batas normal. Kemudian kita lakukan pemeriksaan lebih lanjut. Tapi yang jelas kita temukan kedua lapangan paru penuh dengan wheezing. Wheezing dan ronchi basah kasar. Radiologi tampak gambaran bercak-bercak invertat di kedua lapangan paru. Pada hari ke, ini hari pertama masuk, radiologi menunjukkan tanda-tanda elevated di kedua lapangan paru. Hasil darah lengkapnya, leukosit, antaleukosit menunjukkan harga normal, neutrofilnya 65,20, limfositnya 21, NLR 3,09. Kemudian pada 16 April hari ke, ya masih hari pertama ini, tanda-tanda basic line dari tanda-tanda pengurusan darah, PO27 menunjukkan tanda-tanda hipoksia, sudah menunjukkan tanda-tanda hipoksia. Kemudian kita asesmen sebagai penderita PDP COVID-19 dan hospitalized acute pneumonia. Di samping itu yang bersangkutan memiliki komorbid selain lansia lanjut usia juga diabetes tipe 2. Terapi yang dilakukan adalah terapi cairan, diet 3 kali 3 protein, pemberian azitromisin 500 ml per 24 jam, vitamin C, gemhidronat, hidrokloroquine dan oseltamivir 2 kali 75 mg. Ya, kita planning untuk penekanan diastolis lebih lanjut dengan cek darah rutin per 2 hari, cek CRP, prokestonin dan lain sebagainya. Pada hari kedua, gambaran radiologi menunjukkan invertat tambah banyak di kedua lapangan paru. Hasil swab nasofaring pertama positif COVID-19. Sehingga kita diagnosis sebagai penderita COVID-19 terkonfirmasi. Keadaan umum penderita kompos medis sedang dan SpO2 97% dengan udara, dengan oksigen ruangan. Pasien dengan confirm COVID-19, kita lakukan penata laksanaan dengan terapi cairan, antibiotika azitromisin, vitamin C, oseltamivir, hidrokloroquine, ditambah dengan hidronat. Plan selanjutnya adalah selain darah rutin lengkap kita evaluasi, juga radiologi tiap 3 hari. Swab nasofaring, evaluasi tiap 3 hari. Hasil pada hari kelima dari tempat kita adalah tanda-tanda rilis, perbaikan pada gambaran radiologi kedua lapangan paru. hari berikutnya tanda-tanda laboratorium darah menunjukkan tanda-tanda perbaikan. Limfosit meningkat, neutrofil juga meningkat, sehingga menunjukkan tanda-tanda perbaikan. Pasien dengan 62 tahun dengan COVID-19 terkonfirmasi, hasil swab kita ulang tanggal 25 itu berarti hari ke-9 hasilnya negatif, dan hari ke-12 juga hasilnya negatif. Dari hasil swab evaluasi itu, maka klinis menunjukkan tanda-tanda perbaikan dengan terapi azitromisin, utamanya azitromisin dan hidrokloroquine, maka pasien dinyatakan sembuh dan dilakukan rawat jalan ambulator. Itulah sedikit aspek kita, pengalaman kita di dalam mengenai kasus-kasus yang terduga terkonfirmasi COVID-19. Dua di antaranya memang terkonfirmasi, satu di antaranya tidak terkonfirmasi. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih Prof. Suradi atas penjelasannya. Kita sudah mendengarkan beberapa kasus yang dirawat di Indonesia. Kemudian pembicara kedua kita adalah dari Malaysia, Profesor Dr. Yashodhara. Beliau ini adalah lulus sebagai dokter dari University of Missouri, India. Terus kemudian menjalani Postgraduate Institute of Medical Science juga di India. Terus Profesor Yashodhara ini juga menjalani pendidikan di Royal College of Physicians di UK dan Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh. Profesor Yashodhara telah menjalani praktis medis selama 17 tahun. Okay. Beliau sudah menulis banyak publikasi dan sudah disitasi lebih dari 329 orang. Kepada Profesor Yashodhara dari Malacca Medical College, kami persilahkan.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Prof. Jaspal, Dean Prof. Adinagara, Dean of UMS, all the fellow faculties and students of Malacca Manipal, all the presenters of UMS, Prof. Nachep, and all the students and faculty of UMS. So first of all, I would like to start with, I believe all of you can see, right?
Yes, we can see your slide.
Yeah. Okay, clearly. So before I start my listening talk, I would like to take you back to the slide from the statistics of the corona patients from New York City. You can see here, most of the deaths are in the middle and old age. And these people who have passed away is because of a lot of comorbidities, underlying comorbid conditions. And I think I'll be using this particular info later in my presentation also. And similarly, you can see the city of origin of this virus infection, Wuhan. And the study also indicates that people who passed away died because of this illness are more in the age group of older, and especially those people who have comorbidities like hypertension, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, any other comorbidities. And they did the study further, and they found that there are predictors. You can notice that from the beginning itself. Those people who have comorbidities have poorer outcome, and those people who don't have comorbidities, they have better outcome. And if the number of comorbidities is more than when the mortality is much higher compared to the people who have comorbidity only one. And this is confirmed from the Wuhan studies. So what they have used in the past for the managing those patients who had an outcome, so they used steroids, they used ventilation, they used various groups of medicines. And most important thing is they used advanced organ support systems like ICU, oxygen, ventilation, ECMOs, renal replacement therapy, antiviral drugs, antibiotics like the professor just mentioned, and supportive therapy. And number of days depends upon all those comorbidities and other aspects. Of course, when they were investigated, they included all the infection screening, organs, organ functions like FVC, kidney function, liver function, interleukin 6 level, procalcitonin, LEH, interleukin 6. These are the markers of cytochrome storm, which happens in patients who go into the last stages of COVID infection, especially ARDS. And this slide is taken from US. It just shows out of the 100 people, for example, infected with COVID, 50% will have no symptoms and 50% will have symptoms, and that symptoms may vary. It can be mild and they can recover. They can have moderate infection, and then after some time they can recover. And some of them pass into the critical stage, and those people who enter the critical stage, maybe 35 to 50% will recover, but remaining majority of them who enter the critical phase will have mortality or more severe morbidity, depending upon the comorbidities and other things which happen, which is a dynamic event during the course of the illness. This slide is taken from Harvard University. They have published an important information, which is helpful in terms of categorizing the patients, staging them from early infection to the middle stage, pulmonary infection to the hyperimmune response system, which is cytochrome storm. The stage one is viral infection, okay, where they will have typical flu-like symptoms or may not have symptoms. And then they went in, going to the pulmonary stage over a period of days. So this is a critical phase, because if you recognize these patients and treat very, very appropriately, you can prevent the migration into the stage three, which is ARDS and critical illness picture. So these are the clinical symptoms of patients having mild illness, like they can have fever, dry cough. And remember, this dry cough. They can have GI symptoms. They can have shortness of breath, typically like pneumonia picture. We treat CAP kind of patients in the stage two, where they have shortness of breath, hypoxia. And then they enter the critical phase, hyperimmune, cytokine storm picture. And clinical pictures are important from the point of view of initiating the therapy. So this slide is taken from the Cleveland Clinic of General Medicine. I use a similar idea. So in the beginning, they are in the viral phase, and they enter into the pulmonary phase. So in that pulmonary stage is the one where they can mount an inappropriate, or very abnormal inflammatory response, which leads to ARDS picture in stage three. So this is the data from Malaysia. Luckily, because of various measures initiated by the government, number of cases every day are in the plateau phase. A number of discharges are increasing. And so far, I think there were about roughly 100 deaths all over the country. Out of the 6,800 patients who were infected, roughly about 5,400 patients have been discharged, and 1,304 patients still in treatment stage in various stages. So that's because of public measures taken because of movement restrictions or disorder, order, where people have been not allowed to move in public places. And luckily, this number of cases is flattening. And number of more cases are mostly in Kuala Lumpur, Negeri Sembilan, Johor, and Sarawak. Ministry of Health has actually issued guidelines for the doctors to stage the patient's illness. And these are for the sake of initiating appropriate therapy, categorized into stage 1, 2, 3, and 4, and 5. Stage 1 is asymptomatic patients. Stage 2 is symptomatic but no pneumonia. Stage 3 are the patients who have symptoms but they have pneumonia. And stage 4 are the people with pneumonia, and they require oxygen in the form of various aspects like simple oxygen, nasal cannula, high-face face mask, oxygen therapy, NIV, are maybe they move into the stage 5 where there is ARDS picture requiring multi-organ support, including ventilator support in the ICU. All these patients need to be monitored for warning signs. This is very important because when we start treating these patients, it will help in initiating other modalities of treatment which can be applied. So these warning signs are fever, drop in absolute lymphocyte count, or increasing CRP and tachycardia. So further categorization can be done for the sake of initiating very accurate therapy. Category like one is, like I mentioned, asymptomatic. Category two are the patients with no pneumonia. Category three are the people with pneumonia but don't require oxygen. Category four are the people with pneumonia but require oxygen, like I mentioned before, from nasal cannula, face mask, high flow nasal oxygen, or NIV, or maybe ventilator support towards the critical illness. Category five are the ones who are very ill, who have multiple organ dysfunction, shock, and ARDS. So those people who are in the early stages can be asked to monitor themselves, or they can be monitored with respect to these symptoms like fever, cough, shortness of breath. And when this picture appears, we need to take appropriate steps, especially if the patient complains of fever and cough in the beginning and then later becomes short of breath. So those patients need to be subject for chest X-ray imaging to know whether the patient has pneumonia. And then you have to initiate other workup, like investigations, full blood count, organ functions, inflammatory markers, and things like that. So when categorizing the patients, especially the patients moving from stage 2 to stage 3, 4, and 5, this modified early warning system is very, very beneficial, because this will tell you, this will guide you where to place your patients. Patients need to be kept in the observation ward or can be escalated into high dependency or critical care. So this includes respiratory rate, heart rate, systolic blood pressure, AVPU, which is alert, no neurological dysfunction, responding to verbal command, pain, and unresponsive kind of thing. And like I mentioned before, temperature is a very important aspect of subcategorization of patients. And you're not good to tell, to note down whether the person has developed AKI requiring CRRT or any other dialytic therapies. So this is in a nutshell. So we have stages. Stage 1, early infection. Stage 2, pulmonary phase. Stage 3 is hyperimmune stage. So stage 1 typically lasts for day 1 to day 5. And pulmonary phase lasts from 5 to 12 days, like we discovered from the presentation from a pulmonologist or pulmonologist. And this has important aspects here, because the patients are gradually having drop in the viral count, but they are moving into the inflammatory stage where the requirement for oxygen, there might be raising CRP, worsening of chest X-ray features, or as they migrate to the later stage, they can have elevated CRP, ferritin, drop in ALC, they can have multi-organ dysfunction. That is from the stages point of view. From the patient category point of view, we can have asymptomatic patients, like I mentioned, category 1. Category 2 are symptomatic but no pneumonia. Category 3 are the ones with symptoms and pneumonia. And category 4 are requiring oxygen with pneumonia. Category 5 require really intensive phase because of cytokine storm. So COVID management, I can just in a nutshell briefly tell you that there are four aspects to this. One are drugs, which are mainly hydroxychloroquine, antivirals, obviously, because this is a viral illness. And next, you can initiate other modalities like interferon or IL antagonists or maybe steroids. And of course, taking care of the sepsis, because which is an inevitable outcome in patients entering stage 4 and stage 5, category 4 and category 5. And patient also requires LNWH, anticoagulation therapy to prevent the microthrombi. I'm going to explain to you in the next slide why this is important. Of course, general measures are very important, which is going to help in getting the better outcomes, like nutrition, bowel care, organ support, looking for drug interactions, because we are using so many medications. Of course, when the patient is on ventilation, sedation issues are there, Once the patients start improving, we need to do the SBT trial, anticoagulation to prevent venous thromboembolism because patients are bedridden. And next is managing the comorbidities. Just for example, if the person is given antiviral therapy like Kaletra, which is a combination of lopinavir plus ritonavir, it can result in elevated triglycerides and it can produce elevated glucose levels. And especially if your patient is diabetic, and given this particular thing, you need to closely monitor diabetic care, which is going to affect our outcome. So managing comorbidity is the third aspect, and everything else is the last part. We have to ensure that we don't get infected. PPE, infection prevention control measures, which is very, very important. We are not just treating the patients. We are taking care of ourselves, our fellow colleagues. We should ensure that the other patients don't get infected through the equipment or the manpower. Okay, so that's very important. Next is imaging. Imaging is an issue because these patients, especially in stage or category 5, will be ventilated. Doing CT scans and all those things is very difficult. So a point of care ultrasonography using handheld ultrasonography, all those things are very, very important. And the number three aspect is pick up the best practices by knowledge sharing. I think the medications, all of them which we are using are off-label. They are not being proven in the randomized controlled trials. I think WHO is conducting solidarity trial and other institutions all over the world are starting randomized controlled trials. And I think all the therapies which we are applying now is going to be subjected to change depending upon the outcome of what we are going to get in the future. So WHO has also suggested that we should use the SOFA score, especially as I mentioned before, managing comorbidities, looking at the respiratory abnormalities, whether they are moving from better to worse, or they are getting better, or they are becoming bad, or whatever. Coagulation screen is very important, taking care of the liver functions, cardiovascular, central nervous system, and renal functions. So this is the Ministry of Health Malaysia guideline. So category 1 patients, we just observe them. And category 2 patients, we use HCQ, hydroxychloroquine, which is better compared to chloroquine in terms of side effect profile, absorption, and efficacy. So we use 400 milligram on day 1 and 200 milligram for that 4 days in category 2 because these are mild cases. Alternatively, like mentioned before, we can use chloroquine. Category 3 patients with pneumonia, we can use same medicine, but we increase the duration of HCQ, about 7 to 14 days. But if the patient has warning signs or comorbidities, in category 3, we'll be starting Kaletra BD for 7 to 14 days. Category 4 is almost similar, but we have to initiate the oxygen therapy, like maybe nasal oxygen, face mask, or NIV, but keep an observation on these patients. These are the people who will be who have the potential to deteriorate into category 5. Category 5 will do the same thing, but in addition to HCQ and Kaletra, we add ribavirin, which is used in the treatment of hepatitis C previously, so it can be applied here. And along with it, or maybe if you don't want to use ribavirin, we want to use interferon, either interferon B or interferon 1A. And look for features of cytokine release syndrome, which requires IL-6 antagonists or steroids along with critical care with mechanical ventilation. So warning signs are very important in all the stages, which are fever, dropping ALC, increasing CRP, and tachycardia. So, like I mentioned before, category 1 is observation. Category 2 is HCQ for 4 days. Category 3 is HCQ for extended period of time compared to category 2. But if the patient has warning signs, like I mentioned before, or they have comorbidities, you can use Kaletra for 7 to 14 days. In case you don't want to use Kaletra, you can use other antiviral combination like atazanavir or isatavir or remdesivir or favipavir. Point of care ultrasonography is very important apart from chest x-ray. So chest x-ray is the first thing, which is going to tell you the category of the patient. But you can also look at the other aspects of this in critical illness in the form of point of care ultrasonography, so lung ultrasound, DVT scan, looking at the heart, because it has been found through the WHO studies and other aspects that patients can have myocarditis, patient can have renal failure, liver failure, or even so. These migrations are important. HRCT can actually predict the outcome of the patients right from the beginning. So typically CT scan, which is done after the chest X-ray, may show pulmonary changes, typically ground glass, just isolation. They can find, it can show the pulmonary opacities in the form of pneumonia, and maybe sometimes a combination of both, especially those people who have pneumonic patch and ground glass appearance. The predictability is that these people will be ending up in ICU. So you can keep an eye on those patients, especially CT scan shows pneumonic patch plus ground glass appearance, but they are in maybe category 3. Keep an eye on those patients because they quickly move into category 4 and 5. So this is what has been proven in studies, just like as I mentioned before. Acute phase reactants are very important, like I mentioned in the beginning. So all those procalcitonin, CRP, LDH, IL-6 levels, increasing WBC count, or maybe drop in the lymphocyte count. So they predict the coming of the storm in the form of stage or category 5 or stage 3. So cytokine storm is one of the things which needs to be looked at very carefully. So preliminary studies indicate that immunomodulator therapy like hydroxychloroquine, interleukin-6 antagonists are beneficial. Maybe steroids also beneficial. So like I mentioned before, MUSE, that is modified early warning system, can be applied in all categories of patients looking for migration of the patient's stage or category from early to the stage category 5. So category 5 patients we use here in the hospital as per the guidelines of the Ministry of Health, hydroxychloroquine, antivirals. Remember in my first stage, I told you there is a viral load in the second stage. So it has to be tackled along with immunomodulation, hydroxychloroquine. In case you can't use lopinavir, you can use alternatives. And you add on the third antiviral, that is ribavirin plus interferon. Interferon is typically used as interferon 1A, 44 micrograms EOD, or interferon beta 1B, which is used 8 international units. Plus cover for sepsis, depending upon what you grow on the culture. So you have to keep on doing cultures, monitor all these aspects, and that has to be addressed properly because there is an abnormal immune response. They are just elevated, but they are not taking care of the bacteria which are present in our body. It can come from the gut, it can come from the environment, can come from anywhere. So blood cultures and treating it appropriately is very, very important. So this has been proven in studies from China that especially these people who move into the category 5 and ARDS. So they did the lung biopsy of the patients who have passed away. And they found that there is a lot of deposition of these inflammatory mediators. So this is basically an aberrant, very abnormal immune response, inappropriate to the situation, damaging the host. So they found it's IL-6 deposits. And from the rheumatology point of view, we had the experience treating rheumatology patients, especially rheumatoid arthritis. When they don't respond to typically DMA ARDs, they don't respond to anti-TNF-alpha inhibitors. So those people, when they are treated with tacilizumab, which is IL-6 antagonist, they respond very well. So that experience of using hydroxychloroquine and IL-6 has come from the rheumatology practice. So this was applied in Wuhan, China. So when they used antivirals, methylprednisolone, and they used the IL-6 antagonist, which is tocilizumab, so they had a very good outcome. So out of the 21 patients who were in the category 5, they responded very well. I think weeks after treatment, they became better and they were discharged. So one patient is still in the ICU, I think, at the time of publication of this paper. So we know cytokine storm is very dangerous because it produces ARDS. It damages the membrane in the alveoli, preventing a proper gaseous exchange. So this is a typical known phenomenon. So again, I come back to my slide. the migration of the patients from category 3, 4 to 5 can be predicted early if we can use a modified early warning system. So this is taken from the Royal College of Physicians of UK and NHS UK. So earlier they are using a new early warning system, that is MUSE. It is modified as MUSE. It has got two variants. One can be PMUSE and another can be EMUSE. P is pre-hospital admission predictability when they come into the other settings. And EMUSE is in the emergency department. So these patients can be seen in the emergency department commonly. You can use this MUSE to say whether this patient has to go to directly to the ICU, has to go to the ward. And then those people who are in the ward can be monitored using this particular system, because we want to take care of the existing category 3 and 4, initiate appropriate therapy, because this can potentially prevent the migration into category 5. So category 5 patients, the Ministry of Health guidelines and what is practiced currently, I again emphasize this might be subject to change depending upon the availability of the information which is going to come in the future. So there are so many trials, only few studies have been available with reports. I think you can look up for these things in the PubMed or NIH, National Institute of Health outcomes. So in category 5, I think they would have already been treated with hydroxychloroquine antivirals, maybe second antiviral, third antiviral, have been covered for the antibiotics with sepsis. And then you can either add methylprednisolone or IL-6 antagonists. That's what we use. And of course, when they in the critical phase requiring mechanical ventilation, we must ensure use lung protective ventilation strategies, which is known from the previous ARDS studies. Low tidal volume, don't want to produce pneumothorax and then the lung damage, inflammation. So its mortality is higher if you use high tidal volume, apart from the high tidal volume producing pneumothorax. It can initiate cytokine storm. Pressure support not exceeding 30 centimeters of water. And those people who, in spite of all these measures, the medicines, comorbidity management, lung protective ventilation strategies, antibiotics have been used, some of them still become very sick. And those patients who show drop in the PaO2 by FiO2 ratios, suggesting that nothing is working, so those patients can be subjected to the ventilation in prone position, proning, which is called as proning. And of course, use the focus point of care ultrasonography to look for any lung lesions, new lesions, or you can look at pneumothorax and all those aspects. So this is from the Lancet, actually. It says that same lung protective strategies is very important. And in some countries, they're using nitric oxide, and which is not used here. So in a nutshell, from what is practiced here, so you have to look at the stage of the illness. Stage 1, which is just asymptomatic fever. Stage 2 is pneumonia phase. Stage 3 is ARDS picture. Our category of the patients, category 1 asymptomatic, symptomatic without pneumonia. Category 3 with pneumonia, with or without warning signs. So without warning signs, we use hydroxychloroquine for long period. With warning signs or comorbidities, we add the antivirals, that's typically Calitra. And category 3 with hypoxia, use those oxygen strategies plus ribavirin and subcutaneous interferon. And when the person is in critically ill phase, you can use steroids plus or minus IL-6 antagonists, typically in the form of 8 milligram per kg single dose. So this is not the end of it. It has been shown in studies these patients develop high amounts of thrombosis in coronaries, in the brain, in the kidneys, vessels, especially lower limbs and DVT. High rates of thrombotic complications. And that has caused lots of morbidity and mortality apart from the disease itself or the sepsis. So the markers of this high coagulopathy status is very unusual. It's like it has got high D-dimer values, but normal fibrinogen values. So aggressive VTE prophylaxis is recommended and monitor the D-dimer levels. There are two predictable scoring systems which can be used for VTE risk. One is Padua RAM score, or you can use Caprini RAM score. So these are different from well scoring. So we use here in the hospital Padua RAM score and initiate appropriate therapy, especially for category 3, 4, and 5 patients, not for category 1 and 2. They are low risk categories. Category 3, 4, and 5 patients require proper anticoagulation strategies. So this is a case report from Iceland, just to show that that patient who went outside and then had all those pneumonia patches. CT scan showed consolidation and ground glass patches. So I told you in the beginning, when the person shows two things, one is pneumonic patch plus ground glass appearance, the person migrating into category 5 is very high. So this patient was managed in the ICU with all the treatment, including tocilizumab. So the patient had a good outcome. So there are some things which we discussed, and then there were interesting debates about using ACE inhibitors, because COVID-19 virus makes an entry into the host cell through the ACE2 inhibitors, receptors. But in the beginning, there were conflicting reports saying that we should not continue using ACE inhibitors. Now the evidence is turned against it. We can continue to use ACE inhibitor that has no role in the COVID patients, family COVID patients. Second controversy was vaccinating COVID patients for will it actually enhance the immunity? But WHO clearly says that it's not recommended. It just used BCG for treatment of tuberculosis. It has no role in COVID management. So like I mentioned before, so far the country has experienced mortality of 102 and in that range. And 1,300 patients are still in the management stages of various categories. Roughly about 5,800, 70 to 80% of the patients have been discharged fine. So I thank my hospital colleagues. I also thank CE Prof. Jaspal, Dean Prof. Adinagara, and thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Apologize, Dr. Iin has some technical problem. So I will continue as a moderator. Okay, the third speaker will be our dean. Talk about first-line therapy of COVID-19. Okay, kepada Prof. M. Sutrisna, saya persilahkan. Excuse me, Prof. M. Sutrisna.
Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My topic is first-line therapy candidate for treating COVID-19. As you know, in March 11, 2020, we have decided COVID-19 as pandemic. And now, this disease spread more than 200 countries. You know, COVID-19 was caused by SARS-CoV-2. And you know, the target text of SARS-CoV-2 is AC2. And you know, the AC2 was distributed in many organs, like lung, kidney, cardiac, gastrointestinal, and others. Right? Next slide, Mr. Dari. Right? Yeah, in vitro studies, you know, target SARS-CoV-2 is AC2 inhibitor. AC2 receptor. And AC2 receptor was is distributed in many organs, gastrointestinal, kidney, lungs, and others. And the target attack is different from coronavirus. And GPP4, right? And now, the recent research, the virus can be detected in feces. Therefore, maybe virus can transmit by fecal. Next slide. We will focus on antiretroviral as a first-line treatment. Next slide. What is different between antibiotic and antiretroviral? You know, antibacterial is main agent, high selectivity and low toxicity. But antiretroviral is high toxicity and low strategy. So, sehingga perkembangan development of antiretroviral tidak secepat perkembangan antibakteri. You understand? Sekarang first generation, second generation, third generation, fourth generation, but in antiretroviral, we cannot find it. Right? Classification of antiretroviral. Next slide. Next slide. You know, the classification of antiretroviral was entry inhibitor, NRTI, non-NRTI, endotrexin inhibitor, and protease inhibitor. We study about state of viral replication in concept, right? Kegeruan. Attachment, fashion, uncoupling, replication, assembling, and then maturation and release new viral to attack other cell in concept. This is a replication threat, right? Ini adalah replikasi stage in virus. Right? You know, check out SARS-CoV-2 receptor. Fusion, uncoating, transcription, assembling, and release new vector. Right? Yeah. Right? Sorry, right? Right, Mr. Harari. State of viral replication that can be targeted therapy. Impeded attachment to host cell. Example, infiltrated parafirox, inhibit uncoating, ligase amantadine, inhibit synthesis of viral mRNA, ligase interferon, inhibit translation of RNA, ligase interferon, inhibit replication viral RNA or DNA, NRTI, yeah, and inhibit maturation of new viral protein. Ligase protease inhibitor, right? IRC candidate for treating COVID-19 was remdesivir. Remdesivir is adenosine analog. Mechanism of action is termination premature of SARS-CoV-2. And arguably, this medicine inhibit RDRP, RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. And previously, this medicine was indicated to treat Ebola viral. Research in vitro, isolated cell, shown that remdesivir kills coronavirus effectively. Right? Right? Slide. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide, Mr. Ari. Focus in picture one. Next slide. Next slide. In vitro with viral cell, you know, effective concentration 50 of remdesivir is lowest than antiretroviral. No, 0.77 compared then ribavirin 100 EC50 and fenbidravir. Sorry, fenbidravir 20 ACVD, this concentration, in 68 location, United States, Europe, Asia, found that remdesivir, a patient who treated by remdesivir had faster time to recovery. 11 days versus 15 days versus placebo. And mortality rate remdesivir versus placebo 80% MF, I'm sorry, 8% disease, 11%. Right? Randomized double blind placebo control multi center trial in 10 hospital in the region. Covid more than 230 patient. Four, patient rated by reimbursement had also clinical improvement but not significantly with placebo. Even was reported in 66% versus 64%, but it's not significant difference. And remdesivir was stopped early because adverse event in 12%, 4% in placebo. Focus in clinical improvement rate, clinical improvement rates. On the 7, remdesivir grew 3%. Pasien had clinical improvement. Meanwhile, placebo 3%. That is same, similar. And day 14, remdesivir, number pasien have clinical improvement rate 27% versus 23%. That is not significant different. But in day 28, pasien treated remdesivir, number 65% have clinical improvement, this is 48%, and it is significant different, right? Now, several research undergoing remdesivir clinical trial. I take from PubChem 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 research about remdesivir sedang menjalani clinical trial. Phase 1 and phase 2 and phase 3 clinical trial. Patient with ALT more than 5 upper limit normal and patient with renal failure is contraindication for remdesivir. Right. Combination lopinavir and ritonavir. Lopinavir, as we know, is protease inhibitor in the referral. Lopinavir was catalyzed by CYP3A4. So that is poor bioavailability and slow metabolism. And ritonavir is powerful inhibitor of CYP3A4. So the combination will increase its effectiveness. Yeah. Research by Amber, open label randomized trial and single hospital in human in Wuhan, China, found patient treated by combination lopinavir and ritonavir did not provide significant difference with compare control group or standard therapy. And both group lopinavir and ritonavir and standard group did not show significant in contrasting SARS-CoV-2 RNA in throat swabs, which was read in over time, right? Open label randomized control trial, right? Open label at a standard time involving more than 199 was performed by Bo et al. There is no benefit was detected from lopinavir and ritonavir treatment beyond standard care in the time clinical improvement and risk of mortality. Based on this study, it seemed that the combination of lopinavir and ritonavir is less effective to treat COVID-19. Right, figure 3, from figure, we know, we can see the viral load of combination lopinavir and ritonavir higher than control group. ND5, D14, right. Adverse effect. Total adverse effect between combination lopinavir and ritonavir compared standard care. Yeah. Not significantly different. Yeah. 48% with 49%. Right? But serious adverse event, serious adverse event. Yeah. Right. Serious adverse event. 20% group, but standard care 22%. So that is significant different. Right? This is a structure molecule of lopinavir, right? Ritonavir, right? And chloroquine. Previously, you know, chloroquine was indicated to anti-malaria and effective for SARS-CoV-1 infection. The medicine was allegedly inhibit test to virus to host and effective against SARS-CoV-2, but in vitro test design, not clinical trial. And mechanism of action of chloroquine may be blocking poison, inhibit uncoating, and lysosome alkylation. No, clinical efficacy of chloroquine against COVID-19 is clinical trial is evaluated. Several effects were reported on chloroquine, among others, increased risk for retinal damage and cardiac arrhythmia, especially for long-term treatment. Right. 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 This is the molecule chloroquine. Right. Yes. Mechanism of action of chloroquine. Right. Inhibit fusion. Inhibit uncoating. Yes. Right. There are several clinical trials for chloroquine to against COVID-19. Right. Phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3. Right. Hydrochloroquine. So this time, this medicine indicated to treat lupus and rheumatoid arthritis, you know. But hydrochloroquine in vitro has activities against SARS-CoV-2. The IC50 hydrochloroquine is 6.25 micromol and better than chloroquine. IC50 hydrochloroquine is better than chloroquine. Previous slide. Slide sebelumnya. Yeah. Limited clinical trial, non-randomized with 53 subjects, found 70% of treated group by hydrochloroquine was virologically cured compared 12% in control group on day 6. Right? And it is significant different in vitro. Right, it was right. The serious adverse effect of hydrochloroquine was, you know, right sebelumnya. Right sebelumnya. Yeah. Prolonged QT, increasing risk of retinal damage, especially for lung punctures. Yeah. Right. No, several clinical trial of hydrochloroquine, phase 2 and phase 3, but not complete. Tapi berakhir, right? Next slide. Next slide. Yes. Tapi berakhir was indicated to treat influenza viruses previously, but this medicine was very effective against virus, various type of influenza virus. And, you know, bupivacaine is broad spectrum antiretroviral. The mechanism action, allegedly inhibit RARP, RNA dependent RNA polymerase. Limited clinical trial, 70 subjects found. The patient treated by bupivacaine, or this medicine is effective treating the disease with minor side effect, right? There are three clinical trials for favipiravir undergoing, yeah, phase 2, right? And you know, target point of favipiravir is inhibit RDRP, RNA dependent RNA polymerase, right? Oseltamivir, we know previously, oseltamivir was used for treatment influenza A and B, and mechanism of action, the antiretroviral is neuraminidase inhibitor. Yeah. Research report in Wuhan in April March, no positive result on treatment with oseltamivir, and several clinical trials are still being conducted to evaluate the effectiveness of oseltamivir in the treatment of SARS-CoV infection, right? And there are two clinical trials of oseltamivir for COVID-19. Phase one, and combined with hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin, right? Umefenofer has effect on influenza A and B. Ebola virus has an umefenofer, and lopinavir and ritonavir has better effect than lopinavir and ritonavir alone. But umefenofer alone has lower effect in clinical recovery rates and relief of fever and colds compared than favipiravir. This was a prospective study. Right, and latest human recombinant soluble angiotensin converter in situ. The use of drug is based on AC2 involved as target cell for COVID-19. This protein protects lung damage caused by respiratory distress, and this medicine may have antiviral activity to SARS-CoV-2. In vitro, this medicine inhibits SARS-CoV-2 infection by inhibiting the attachment of virus to the cell. And now, with name APN1, the medicine is undergoing to phase 2 clinical trial, involving 22 participants with randomized single group assignment. Right? Conclusion, sebenarnya several drugs, several medicine, yeah, is undergoing clinical trial, like as sirolimus, tocilizumab, sarilumab, convalescent plasma, and others. Tetapi saya tidak tampilkan dalam slide ini. And conclusion, until today, there is no established strain treatment for COVID-19, and several candidates are remdesivir, chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, favipiravir, and human recombinant soluble angiotensin converting enzyme 2. I think that's enough. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih kepada Bapak Dekan FKUMS. Our last speaker is Professor Dr. M. Nachia Pan. He is a graduate from medical doctor from India. He has also medical degree from Fellow of Royal College of Edinburgh, United Kingdom, Singapore General Hospital, and Academy of Medicine, Malaysia. He is now as a head of Department of Surgery, Malacca Matbal Medical College of Malaysia. He is going to take a topic in the role of universal precaution during COVID-19 pandemic. Kepada Profesor Dr. M. Nachia Pan, saya persilakan.
Okay, thank you, Norita Nuridiyati, for the kind introduction. Can you hear me?
Yes,
okay.
Yes, we can hear you clearly.
Okay, thank you. Okay, this is the frontage of Malacca Manipal Medical College, frontage of the administrative building. And good afternoon in Indonesia. Selamat sore. Okay, to all the participants of this webinar, I like to thank the organizers, both in the UMS as well as the CEO of Melaka Manipal Medical College, Professor Jaspal Singh, and the Dean of Melaka Manipal, Professor Adi Nagar. Okay, it is said that the best form of treatment is prevention. And the prevention is always initiated with taking appropriate precautions.
I'm sorry, Professor. Your slide has been shared screen yet?
Can you see the slide?
No, we haven't seen
it. Okay,
your
hold
slide.
On, hold on. Okay. Can you see now? Hello?
Hello, not yet.
You cannot see yet?
No.
Oh.
We have already your slide here, or apa mungkin bisa kita bantu share-kan, Prof?
Yeah. Can you see?
Oh, okay. Now
you see.
We have seen, yes, we have
okay.
seen your
right.
slide. Okay, please continue.
All right, thank you. Okay, what I said was, this was the frontage of Melaka Manipal Medical College Administrative Building. And as I said earlier, I'm going to talk about precautions. And as we all know, that the best form of treatment is prevention, and prevention is always initiated by taking appropriate precautions. When I talk about universal precautions, it is actually this word, universal precaution, was coined by the CDC in USA during the outbreak of the AIDS epidemic in 1985. And thereafter, that this universal precaution at that time only applied to the hospital personnel, healthcare personnel, as well as the places where this is implemented is in the setting of hospitals. But now what we are doing is, this we have gone far beyond the hospitals and far beyond health personnel in this prevention, and we are applying these universal precautions in a different way. Okay, we all know that there's a chain of infection, virus or bacteria, whatever it is, there's a chain of infection. And you must have a susceptible host, you must have an infectious agent, a reservoir, portal of exit, mode of transmission, portal of entry. Okay, this is a chain, or you call it the cyclos infecti, cycle. So what happens, by taking certain universal precautions, we can break the chain at every level. At every level, you can break this chain of transmission of the infectious disease. Okay, and the infected host, for example, okay, it can be isolated or quarantined so that it does not infect others. For infectious agent itself, okay, the lot of treatment at the moment are being contemplated. And even today morning, I remember Prof. Jaspal Singh, the CEO, just told me that there's a new type of antibodies, targeted monoclonal antibodies, which is 100% effective. Okay, they found and is going for a test. And of course, these infectious agents, till we are going to become immune, either by through herd immunity or by vaccination, is going to be a problem. Then next is the portal of exit. From there, the reservoir is, of course, the respiratory tract, and the portal of exit is, of course, we all know, by through the respiratory tract outlet, and the mode of transmission by coughing, sneezing, or even saliva, or whatever mode, and that you get it, and portal of entry is, again, through our nose, mouth, and eyes, and so on. So what happens at the portal of exit, we can always have a mask, and the portal of mode of transmissions, we always wash our hands, and we cover our face and so on, and this is what we are doing at the moment, okay? And you will find that the best, the initial and the first step that all the governments in the world, they have taken is to isolate, okay? And this isolation, okay, is it is social distancing. This is what almost every country have practicing. There is a reason for it. If you look at this graph, and they all talk about the R number here. On your right, you can the screen R number, and we call it the R naught or reproduction number. Okay, as long as the reproduction number is one or above, there going to be an exponential rise in the cases. Okay, and if the reproductive number or the R naught is less than one, then the cases will come down. We are talking about. We know that in most studies that the reproductive number is about 2.5. That means one single case of positive COVID-19 will infect 2.5 others, and it will go on spreading. So what happens is that we like to reduce this, and if we come to R number, R naught of 0.5, then the one person can only infect half a person. Okay, something like that. Okay, so you'll find that the infection rate can, within 60 days from zero, it can go up to 25,000 cases if it's 1.1. Okay, and it can remain the flat if at the end of 2 months, if it is the reproductive number is 0.5. So the whole social distancing is actually manipulating this reproductive number. Here, this is what happens when you are isolated at home, okay, through a quarantine. In Malaysia, we call it MCO, okay, a movement control order. This is what happens. If we start from zero, and at the day 20 here, at day 20, if you started isolating, total isolation, 100% isolation, then you will find the cases are at 40,000. Okay, from 20,000 at the 20th day, it will go at the 34 days, it will be about 40,000. That means that there are three scenarios here. One scenario is, of course, no isolation at all. You can see the exponential rise in the number of cases. The other case is isolation at the day 20. This red one is isolation at day 21. Just a 1 day difference will make a difference of 40% of increase in cases isolation. So it's extremely important that the isolation is enforced and strictly enforced, and to reduce the number of cases. This is another illustration here. If it's day one, if there was no social distancing, at the end of day 30, you would have had 406 patients being infected. Okay, how did they arrive this figure? Is that the first 4 or 5 days, most likely, say, assuming that this patient have no symptoms and he had happened to infect 2.5 others. At the fifth day, he had symptoms, and we assume that he's quarantined and is no more infected to others because he's quarantined. But the rest, the 2.5 people whom he has infected, he go on to infect others, and at the end of day 30, there will be 460 of them will be infected. If it is 75% reduction, that means they only allow for a basic mingling of people, 75% of isolation, then at the day 30, it's only about 2.5 infected. So this is very important figure that we must keep in mind. This is the story of Malaysia. What happened in Malaysia was, we started, the first case was started somewhere in January 29th Yes, first case was in January 29th. And for us, the COVID-19 is actually COVID-20, because we didn't have a case in 2019. The graph went up. If we look at here down, the graph here, okay, went up upward from March 14th. From March 14th, suddenly there was a rise here. And on 18th March, we were in the late containment phase. And our R, you can see R naught here, my cursor here, R naught was 3.5, is a way high than average 2.5. Malaysia had a R naught of 3.5. And that is when we went to a mitigation phase and there was a MCO was proclaimed, movement control order, which was very, very severe or very restrictive movement control order was in force. I think Indonesia also, they have a lockdown called Karantina Kewilayahan, I think, so they called it there. And what has happened was there was phase one, phase two. Initially, there were 2 weeks of MCO. Next was another 2 weeks of MCO extended. And third is a modified means they allowed movements to two people can go out to buy essential goods and so on. And what happened was the case has fallen down. You can see the green part is how the number of cases came down. And by 12th of May, we had a reproductive knot of 0.3. Way down. That means if this is continuous and we continue to practice the social distancing, by end of June, we should not be having any cases at all. However, if the when the social distancing restriction is removed, then if we are not following social distancing ourselves, even though that you're not home alone, but you're going back to work or schools open and so on, there is a possibility of a rise in the number of cases. We must know why this is important, this social distancing, to reduce the reproductive number so that the curve here, we can see my cursor here, which was, this is what happened in March, beginning of April, Malaysia, the rate. But what happened is that we were able to flatten the curve here because of the movement control restriction. And so that when it is flattened, our healthcare system capacity is not overwhelmed. That means we are still able to manage the cases. Because if it goes above, our healthcare system will not be able to manage the cases. So this is what happens with the movement control order. And we have said there's at least must be 6 feet from one person to another, because we assume that this is mainly transmitted almost transmission is by droplet infection, and droplet being can fall down by gravity, and we think that 6 feet is a quite good distance to avoid droplet infection. And this social distancing does not involve just the staying at home. And what has happened is that all flights which are non-essential were stopped. All the places where there's a congregation, like schools, colleges, movie theaters, bars and pubs, they all were closed. Okay. And wherever there is a red zone where a lot of cases, there was a very strict, you can't go out of the house at all. And of course, the individual distancing of 6 feet, we go and buy essential goods in supermarket and so on, they ensure that you're not closer than 6 feet. And of course, you stay at home. And this is the one single factor which has reduced the number of cases. And that's what this one single factor is doing the same thing in every part of the world. But we can't have this forever. We have to function, otherwise our economy will go down. Okay, schools have to function. colleges have to function, everything has to function, you have to return to normalcy. But when you're coming to normalcy, we have to follow certain precautions. This is very important. Even if you go to the office, we should avoid in-person meetings. Even within the same building, we can still use internet to communicate unless it's really, really necessary. That's one. Number two, the in-person meetings should be short, not for hours, it should be short. And the meeting place must be large enough so that they can sit quite far apart. Okay, social distancing can be practiced. And the third one is eliminate all unnecessary travel. If you can do the work from the home, please do so. If we have to come to the office because the work cannot be done efficiently without going to the office, only then we should go to the office. Okay. And all public places, like pantries in the workplace, the copier machines, where there should not be, there should not be any crowding. Next is, of course, cafeterias. It's the best policy to bring your own lunch, eat at your own desk. Even if you go to the canteen, you get a packed food and come to your room or a cubicle to have your food. And wherever, if you are staying nearby, try to walk, cycle, or drive a car and so on. Don't avoid the rush hour crowding and so on in a public transport. We always worry about public transport. In Malacca, it's a very fairly smaller town, and quite a lot of people have their own transport to go, and we're not so much worried about this public crowding. And even lecture in the case of like a medical colleges and so on, when they reopen, the lectures can be still be conducted online, and the small group can be done in a smaller classrooms with the proper social distancing. The other thing is that what we are practicing is the washing the hands often with soap and water for at least 20 seconds. We know that any type of soap is fine. Not necessary is a bactericidal soap, because the soap will attack the lipid layer of the viruses. And what is important is that this the education of the masses. I think doctors are quite okay with this. Okay, and I as a surgeon, I learned how to wash my hands properly only when I took up surgery. Okay, we forget that the organisms get into the crease of the palm. We forget that organisms reside in the workspaces of the fingers. We forget that under the nail bed and the crevices along the nails are the places which need to be washed and scrubbed, because that is where the infective organism lurks. And what happens that the masses, the public must be taught, your children must be taught, the students must be taught how to wash their hands. Okay, taking care that each of these hidden areas in your hands are washed, are scrubbed properly, and so on. In case we don't have access to the soap and water, now the WHO says not necessarily warm water, any water is quite okay. Okay, in case you don't have an access to soap and water, then you have to use an alcohol-based hand sanitizer. And the WHO's recommendation is that at least must be 60% alcohol. And nowadays we can see in our supermarkets and so on, our alcohol-based sanitizers are 70%. So what has happened is, again, you should be use liberal amounts. I've seen people are very stinging on that. Cannot be. We should use at least more than 5 mils of the alcohol-based sanitizer and rub the hands with all the crevices of your hands are properly exposed to the sanitizing solution. And you should be air dried, because without we don't air dry it, then you go near a fire, you could catch fire. Okay, and of course you don't unnecessarily touch your eyes, nose or mouth with unwashed hands. Okay, and if you think there are people who are having fever or respiratory symptoms, please keep away, or that person must not be allowed to come to work. And of course, you should get the superior to get the medical help. Okay, once the MCO is lifted, the first thing that we are going to do is a non-contact thermometer to read your temperature. So thermal scanning is very, most popular is the infrared scanner like here. It must be held at a proper distance between 3 cm to 15 cm. Okay, beyond that, it is less effective. Too near is also, you can give a wrong reading. So the whoever takes the temperature must be taught as to what distance they should take this temperature. So if the colleges or the institution or the factory which reopens, they should have only a single accident entry and exit, and somebody must be screening this every worker, okay, for thermal temperature screening, and they should be provided with the mask, they should be provided with the sanitizing solution, and their name should be entered. Suppose that's a visitor, there should be a logbook where their name and addresses are entered and so on, so their contact tracing will be easier. Okay, this is one of the things even to enter the premises where you're going to work. This is initially, see, the lot of things which we thought was a norm was not a norm, okay, in this crisis. People say, wear a mask, don't wear a mask and so on. I think everybody should wear a mask for a simple reason. Okay, when you wear a mask, you are protecting others, okay, so that your saliva or sputum or whatever it is do not come out, and you're protecting others. And at the same time, it prevents you from touching your nose and the mouth, okay. You unnecessarily, this, since it's a mask, it will prevent you to unnecessarily touch your nose and the mouth, and I think that way it helps. Okay, nowadays I think that, everyone in Malaysia is wearing a mask, and the types of masks, we will talk about it. There are so many types of masks here, you can see. Of particular things, you can forget about all the other respirators. The surgical mask here, an N95 respirator. There was initially some controversy whom to wear what, okay? And now we know that the N95 respirator is mainly for those people in the hospitals who are treating a known COVID-19 positive patient or suspected PUI, suspected COVID-19, then they use a N95 respirator. Is not for the general public, not for general workers, not for the not even for doctors who are not coming near, anywhere near a suspected COVID patient. We can use a surgical mask. And here again, there's a controversy, whether it's a 1-ply, 2-ply, or 3-ply. The best form of surgical mask is a 3-ply. The 3-ply mask is got a 3 layers. The outer layer, which is hydrophobic, that means any secretions which you come into touch, it does not soak through. The second layer is a filtering layer, which not allow microns to go, small particles they filter. The inner layer, the third ply, is the hydrophilic, which means your secretions will not come out, okay? And this is the best 3-ply surgical mask is the best for most of us, okay? Except the frontliners who are caring for them. And these respirators, now the both the CDC as well as the WHO says you can have a re-sterilize up to 8 times, which will nowadays they use the best form of sterilization, UV radiation, by I think it's about 235 of 345 nanometers of this one, which is very simple, easy to for having UV radiation and reuse for the same. So for the same person, suppose I wear this N95 respirator, it is labeled and it is you have a UV radiation, and the same mask will come to me only, not to others. Okay, yeah, this is again what I said, between the difference between surgical mask and N95 or similar type. And the surgical mask is mainly have a one-way protection. That means from you to others. whereas N95, the two-way protection is from others to you and you to others as well. Okay, and next one. Okay, this is the other thing that we need to teach the public as well as our children, school-going children and so on, is that how to wear the mask. Okay, first of all, even before you start wearing a mask, we must make sure that you wash your hand with soap and water or alcohol sanitized. That means your hands do not have any infective organism there. Then you will wear either a loop mask or a tie mask, okay? And then make sure that the metal edge, the one side of the mask is got a metal, you have to pinch the metal neck so that it fits very snugly to the face, okay? And when you're removing the mask, you should not touch this body of the mask itself, but you should take out from the loops and you should be able to dispose it off, okay, properly, okay? And not throw it around and so on. And please do not reuse it, okay? This mask should not be reused. This is something that I think we as a healthcare professionals must be able to teach the rest of the people. No? And this is what I was saying. It's very easy to say, avoid touch your eyes, nose and mouth, but it's very difficult because we are conditioned to touch, I think. Okay, we always want to look good or you may have some sort of itchy spot or something like that, and you will always be touching this. And this is why we said wearing a mask has got another benefit, that it prevents you from touching your nose, mouth at least, but not your eyes. Okay, but having a mask may remind you not to touch your face. Okay, this is important. Okay, this is another controversy. Is can you wear a mask and do some outdoor activities like running, jogging, walking, and so on? Like in Malaysia now, they have relaxed the rules of the movement control order, and you can come out to do exercise and so on, but to keep a proper distance. And here the proper distance, first of all, is people in Wuhan, they had fatalities, people wearing masks and running and collapsing because they said the air, oxygen entry is reduced, and the people with the respiratory problem and other illnesses, when they wear a mask and run, and it can cause problem. So if you are having an outdoor activity, please, like running and jogging, don't wear a mask. And the distance, the jarak, social, is not 6 feet anymore. I think you should double the distance. Okay? And that means it will be more than 2 meters, okay, between one person and another person. And okay, this was a study done, done in 2014. And it came out in American Journal of Infection, telling that about transfer of bacteria relative to a moderate strength handshake, what's the percentage, okay? And you will find that handshakes is a very sure way of transferring bacteria, okay? Even a bump, like give a high five, you have got almost 60% transfer of bacteria. Just a brief contact, high five, okay? Mm-hmm. And a fist bump will cost you about 25% and so on. So I think that we want to greet some people, we should learn no more to shake hands and so on. Okay, so, and we use our own traditional ways, okay, of no-touch greetings. Okay, this one is what is practiced in the hospital. Okay, that is these are called 5 moments for hand hygiene. When all we need to do a hand hygiene in the hospital. One was before a patient contact, so that you will not give a patient some infection. Number two, before any aseptic task. Okay, you have to wash your hand. Okay, and number three, after any body fluid exposure, okay, like you touch the patient, nasogastric tube, or a bladder catheterization tube, or whatever, okay, you have to wash. Then after any kind of patient contact, you touch the patient, you have to, before you touching the next patient or moving away from that patient, you have to wash. And after the contact with the patient surroundings, not only the patient, even the patient's bedstead, okay, the side table, whatever it is, you have to wash. If you touch that, you have to wash when you're leaving the place. This is the 5 moments of hand hygiene. So now what happens, we are going to practice at a workplace that you might be touching the lift, you might be touching the railing, you may be touching the wall or the door handles of your bathroom and so on, common bathroom or pantry. So what happens, every time you had kind of touch, you just remember, you extend this 5 moments of hand hygiene to the your surroundings now, okay? So that you should have in your pocket hand sanitizer, okay, so that in case you come into contact or touch, you should be able to use a hand sanitation. And as I said, in addition to performing hand hygiene in all the 5 moments, it should be performed the following situations. Before putting on PPE, the PPE is a personal protective equipment. The face mask is a PPE. Then not only the gown, not only the gloves, even the face mask is a PPE. But under WHO, the cloth mask is not a PPE. Okay, it does not come under PPE, but it does afford some protection. Okay, that you sneeze and cough, the droplet does not travel too far. Okay, it might be soaked. And if you keep a proper distance, it's quite okay. Okay, it doesn't go beyond 6 feet, definitely no. So even a cloth mask is protective, okay, to others. So before putting a PPE, you must have to make sure that you sanitize your hands. When you're changing gloves, you must sanitize your hands. And after any contact with the suspected or a confirmed COVID-19 infected patient, or you come in contact with the waste or the environment, then you wash your hands, okay? And for the canteen operators, before food preparation, they should make sure that they cleanse their hands after eating, okay? With your fingers, you have to, of course, have to clean. After using your toilet, you have to clean. So these things have to be taught to everyone. Otherwise, when the lockdown order is lifted, there's going to be a spike if you can't follow this. And this will be, if it's an exponential spike, then it'll overwhelm the health resources to manage that. This is a very important thing that we all should not only practice ourselves, but be able to take this to the masses. And as I said, together, any water will be fine, any soap is fine, not necessarily bactericidal soap. Any soap which can form a leather, the foam, will kill the outer lipid layer of the virus. Okay, the only thing is that you take care to every corner, every crevices are cleansed. And I think in every workplace, this picture must be posted as to see how to clean, how to do. We surgeons have got no problem. A lot of doctors have got no problem. But general public, they normally equate wetting their hands as washing their hands. Both are different. I think this is where the education is important. And as we said, if we do not have access to the running water, then we must have a hand sanitizer. You should have one at your workplace, at your work desk, in your pocket, in your car, and so on. And it's very important. And it should be at least 60%. Okay, most of the commercial preparations are 70%. And this norm has to be followed. This is going to be a new norm till we can overcome the illness globally. And with that, thank you all, and I'll pass to the moderator. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Sapriapan. Maybe before we start our discussions, supaya bisa say hello antara participant dari Indonesia sama participant dari Malaysia, all participant, could you please activate your video? Jadi kepada semua partisipan, mohon untuk mengaktifkan videonya. Itu kita supaya bisa say hello participant from Indonesia and participant from Malaysia. Please, students, are there any students from Indonesia and Malaysia? Please activate your video before we go to discussion sessions. Okay. Mana tadi ya? Okay, we still wait for all participants to activate their video. We already have some questions. Maybe the host could share screen the questions.
Yeah.
Okay, the first question for Prof. Suradi.
Yeah.
Yeah, Prof. Suradi. Yeah. The first questions. Ini dari Saudara Kamres Kumar Dubey. I think this is participant from Malaysia. The question is there any report on particular bacteria isolated by blood or any other media? And I believe vitamin C as an antioxidant. Any report of other known antioxidant, for example, vitamin A? Please, Prof. Suradi, could you please answer the questions?
Okay. Okay. Thank you for your question. My patient, because only three cases, there is no report yet for isolated bacteria from blood culture in our patient. But One of the patient, culture sputum.
Oh, sputum.
Yeah. Yes. The culture sputum. The result is not crude too. Not crude too.
Ya, jadi yang diambil kultur sputum ya, Prof. Tapi ya. tidak tumbuh, no growth.
Tidak tumbuh, khususnya pasien-pasien yang kita ambil itu pasien-pasien yang emergency, pasien-pasien yang intensif, yang kegawatan.
Ya.
Kemudian untuk
vitamin A atau D, Prof. D. Ya.
Ya. Untuk vitamin A dan D memang belum. Belum ada di antara kita yang menggunakan vitamin A dan D yang kita anggap sebagai antioksidan. Yang kita pakai adalah selama ini vitamin C karena yang digunakan sebagai antioksidan dan ini dianggap paling efektif dan paling efisien yang kita berikan kepada yang bersangkutan. Gitu.
Okay, terima kasih Prof. Suradi. The second question untuk Profesor Yasodhara, I believe. Please. This is the questions I would like to ask Profesor Yasodhara regarding silent hypoxia. Okay. And the second question is about what do you think about the passive immunizations? Is they effective against COVID-19? Thank you, Profesor Yasodhara. Could you please answer the questions?
Passive immunization. Is it?
The first one, silent hypoxia and passive immunization, plasma therapy.
Okay, so this is in experimental stages, like it's called as compassionate convalescent therapy, and it's been experimented in many countries. Like I mentioned before, and even many of the speakers mentioned, there is no specific therapy. So the passive therapy is you take the sera from the patients who have known to have recovered from the COVID-19, and then that plasma is infused to the known patients. I think the studies are going on, especially in United States and other countries. So we need to see the outcomes after the randomized controlled trials. There are lots of studies are going on. One of them is the solidarity study from WHO. Many randomized controlled trials are on board. So at this point in time, I think it's quite difficult to say so which one is beneficial. So these are all anecdotal. And then, like I mentioned in the IL-6 antagonistic therapy, it was a study from China involving 21 patients. So only a few anecdotal studies suggesting the role. And like UAD mentioned, those drug-related studies are on in the experimental basis. They are studied in the lab. So this kind of thing is on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. The third question untuk Prof. E.M. Sutrisna, the question is, I want to ask some question from hydroxychloroquine treated patient at baseline that those who did not receive hydroxychloroquine. Okay, please, Professor M, could you please answer the questions?
Thank you very much. Limited data for hydroxychloroquine to management COVID-19. But in vitro, hydroxychloroquine more active than chloroquine.
Jadi effectively yang lebih aktif adalah yang
in vitro hydroxychloroquine more active than chloroquine.
Oh, secara in vitro hydroxychloroquine lebih aktif dibandingkan chloroquine. Oh, okay. Kemudian pertanyaan berikutnya untuk Prof. Natsiapan. Next slide, please. Okay. What kind of factor may have influence on reproductive number? Is individual social networking has more great influence beside the epidemiological spreading of disease? Please, Professor Natsiapan.
Okay. This R naught or the reproductive number is based on assumption that everybody is susceptible. When you say everybody is susceptible, no one has got an immunity to the disease. That's number one. Number two is there are two types of reproductive numbers that you must know. One is called the basic reproductive number, which represents the maximum epidemic potential of a pathogen. It describes what would happen if an infectious person were to enter a fully susceptible community. Whereas there's another reproduction number, which is not a basic reproduction number, but it's known as the effective reproduction number. That effective reproduction number depends on the population's current susceptibility, either due to vaccination or due to subclinical infection and so on. Okay, that is the population current susceptibility will change. Okay, and also demographics like age, the older people are more prone to suffer, and the sex. There's a recent study which tells males or females, one of them more prone, they get worse off with the disease. And also pre-existing diseases like hypertension, diabetes, and so on, all these will alter the reproduction number. Yes.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Natsiapan. We still have 4 more questions. Okay. Bisa ditampilkan yang 4 pertanyaan berikutnya setelah ini. Masih ada pertanyaan. Masih ada waktu untuk menjawab kira-kira 10 menit.
Mas Ari, saya belum bisa share. Sudah, dok, silakan.
Ya. Okay, this is our last four questions. Question for Professor Suradi. Is there any report in particular? Oh, yang tadi sudah ini, yang sesi kedua, the second session. Okay, next. Okay. Okay. Ini ada pertanyaan dari Indonesia, Prof. Suradi. Beberapa pasien telah dinyatakan negatif dua kali, kemudian positif. Jadi we all have a patient who have recovered negative PCR, but then he become another positive PCR, the same patient. Apa yang terjadi pada pasien ini? Apakah reinfeksi ataukah ada faktor yang lain? Terima kasih. Silakan Prof. Suradi.
Ya, setelah dinyatakan negatif dua kali, kemudian dites lagi menjadi positif, maka menunjukkan petanda adanya satu reinfection. Jadi memang kalau sudah negatif kemudian menjadi positif, berarti ada satu faktor imunokompetensi yang aktif lagi, menunjukkan tanda-tanda reinfection. Begitu.
Oke, terima kasih Prof. Suradi. Kemudian pertanyaan berikutnya, ini untuk Profesor Yasodhara. Ya, inpatient COVID-19 occur interferon 1 delay response. SHG is an advanced stage patient. Interferon 1 will increase the production of pro-inflammatory cytokine due to the activation of the line of JAK-STAT, increase the severity of cytokine storm. The question is why the interferon is given to stadium 4 patient and not in early stage patient. Please, Professor Yasodhara.
Okay, I think the interferon actually kills the cells infected by the virus. So when it kills the virus, it will also release the inflammatory mediators, which will produce collateral damage. It's like there are healthy cells surrounding the infected cell. So in the beginning, maybe that the immune response is just appropriate to the amount of viral load that is. So when we use interferon in the early stage, so what will happen, we'll be producing more of collateral damage. Collateral damage means not just killing the cells infected with the virus, not just killing the virus itself, all that excessive barrage of inflammatory cytokines like interleukin 6 and all those things will spill over, will produce more collateral damage, and that has the potential to induce ARDS like HR in the beginning itself. And this is known from treating hepatitis B and hepatitis C infected patients. Once there is compromised liver, very much like a child C and child B kind of thing, so we don't use interferon there. So this is here experimental to prevent the collateral damage. Probably if you don't use them, just treat appropriately, patient may recover on their own before they enter into category 5.
Okay, thank you, Professor Yasodhara. Okay, next question for Prof. M. Sutrisna. Next question from Professor Dr. Nachiapan. How about herd immunity that government plan to manage this pandemic? Is this the best way before the vaccine is found?
Thank you. The WHO has come out very strongly against herd immunity. Okay, that means there's no social distancing. Let the infection spread among the masses and let them develop the herd immunity. What will happen is the overwhelming sudden spike or escalation of cases, none of the countries, their health system cannot manage them. We will not have enough beds in the hospitals. We will not have enough ventilators to support them and so on. So the herd immunity is not a good way at all. Okay, and that is why we need to have this control measures of social distancing and other precautions in place rather than allowing herd immunity to develop. because of the stakes are very high, okay, and we will not be able to manage them. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. For all participants, please activate your video. I would read some of our conclusion for our discussions. In Malaysia, new cases has been decreased, while in Indonesia are still increasing. Both countries choose different approach. Malaysia has chose to totally lock down, while in Indonesia, we choose karantina wilayah skala besar. So we are not totally locked down. It's different from Indonesia and Malaysia. So Indonesia should struggle more to cope this pandemic COVID-19. There are clinical characteristics used by both country. Indonesia use gejala ringan, gejala sedang, gejala berat, sepsis, and AFDS. While in Malaysia use stage 1 until 5. And the similarity drug used in both country are oseltamivir and hydroxychloroquine. There are new antiviral drug which are entering phase 2 until 3 clinical trial. We hope that this clinical trial will be succeed, so we will have another drug more effective for COVID-19. And from Professor Naciapan, I can conclude that social distancing is very important. It had been proved in many countries to decrease and reduce number of cases, including in Malaysia. We need adjustment in our daily practice and behavior. So we use teleconference instead of meeting directly. We should bring our own food or bring our own food to the office. We avoid public transportation. We postponed traveling or recreational study. We have to wash our hands, not to touch our face and nose. And herd immunity is not the, Professor Naciapan said it's not recommended for a solution for COVID-19. Okay, I believe we have entered our end of discussions today. On behalf of all committee members, we apologize if there is a shortcoming in the implementation of this event. Thank you again for all speaker, guests, colleagues from Malaysia. May we all get blessing at the end of the month of Ramadan, and we have the strength to face the days ahead in the middle of this pandemic. Hope we can meet again in another occasions. Before we say goodbye, maybe participant, could you please activate your video? Now, there are still many participants who Akhirul kalam, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, asyhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay, thank you again. See you again in the next session. Bye.
Thank you, Wuyin.
Thank you. To all the participants from Malaysia and Indonesia.
we have closed this meeting, so we can leave this Zoom room. Thank you very much. Thank you again. We will see you later. Bye. Terima kasih Prof. Suladi, Pak Dekan, Prof. Adi Negara, Prof. Yasodhara, Prof. Naciapan, dan Prof. Jaspal Singh dari Malaysia. Thank you.